Congresswoman, it's a pleasure to have you here.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you. And let's begin with this. You have received many honors during your career, but on April 24th, you received a special one. You broke ground on the Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton Green at Georgetown University Law Center. Explain how this is special for you.
It's special, and it was a big surprise.
It was a surprise.
But I have had a number of careers. And one career that I had simultaneously with my career in the Congress was as a tenured professor of law at Georgetown Law School. Now, when I was elected, I wasn't going to give up my tenure. So I taught one course there throughout most of my career in the Congress. And I did not want to leave that part of my life. It made me the intellectual that I was. It made me the writer that I was. And I was in touch with young people every other week.
Right. Amazing. Well, speaking of Congress, this honor comes as a record number of women are in Congress. When you were elected in 1990, there were three women.
Three African-American women,
and now you have the most diverse Congress ever. How has the tide changed on Capitol Hill?
Not enough for me, because if you look at all the women, I don't think we're a quarter of the House of Representatives. That's not America, but it does mean that we've made progress. What it is a signal of is the difficulty of getting elected in the United States, because it requires money. And who had none was me, but somehow I was able in the early 90s to get over that. And I think what is keeping more women from coming to Congress is the financial difficulty of running. But look what happened to Democrats this time. They essentially had another year of the woman. We've had another year of the woman in light of the record number of women who were elected to Congress, the Congress that began in January, right. The 116th Congress.
Right. A lot of your colleagues are calling for impeachment. What's your take on that?
Most of my colleagues are not, and I am not. It's not because I think this president hasn't committed impeachable offenses. It's because I was there when the last impeachment, so to speak, occurred against President Clinton. The House is controlled by Democrats, but the Senate, who would try the case, is controlled by Republicans. If you want to eat up all the time in the 106th Congress on something that cannot happen, bringing our indictment, and that's all we can do in the House, to fruition, which means that you're convicted in the Senate, then you have eaten up the kind of time it takes to get reelected again into 2020. Even as it is, I think most Americans aren't even focusing on the many bills we've passed in the House. So an impeachment is like a lollipop. I'd like to get some of that, but when you think it through, you see that you're not going to get the whole thing.
Right. Well, you live in Washington now. You're fourth generation, right? Washington.
Third generation.
You're third generation, but you also lived in New York City for a while. And when you were here, you were the first woman to lead the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. Tell us about your fight, your epic battle for equal pay, and compare it to now.
Yes, I was the first woman to chair the New York City Commission on Human Rights, and then I was the first woman to chair the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. And I must say it's a real sense that I began my career in public life here at the New York City Commission on Human Rights. I had always been first and foremost a civil rights lawyer, and I got to act that out in public office at the New York City Commission on Human Rights, at the EEOC. And yes, all of those women's issues were on the table. When I had my first child, and both of my children were born at Mount Sinai Hospital here, when I had my first child, pregnancy was not even included in insurance policies that you could pay for. They just took that out. Of course, almost every woman had a pregnancy, but it shows you how far behind we were and the distance we have come since.
Right. Right now, there are a record number of women running for president. And as a veteran lawmaker and a civil rights lawyer, someone with so much wisdom, you have so many people you've mentored over the years. What advice do you have for the six women Democrats running for president?
First of all, run, girl, run. I think that the fact that so many women are running is such a sea change in our country that even if they do not prevail, presidential campaigns will never be the same again.
Right. And one of the things you're very passionate about, of course, is your bill H.R. 51 for D.C. statehood. You've been fighting for this for a long time. Do you feel the tide has turned in your favor?
I do, and I so appreciate your mentioning that. The people I represent are number one per capita. It's even more per capita than New York in taxes paid to support the federal government. And still, they have no senators. They have only me in the House. I vote on some matters on the House floor, but most matters, I can't even vote on the House floor. So this bill has almost enough co-sponsors to be passed by the House. In 218 years, there has been no recognition in the House and the Senate of the people who live in your nation's capital. I am called a delegate, and I'm a delegate and a member. A delegate means you don't quite have the same thing that other members have. Why not? Pay our taxes. Among the oldest jurisdictions, well, it looks like we're getting there with H.R. 51, the D.C. Admissions Act.
Okay, well, we will be keeping tabs on that. And thank you for your time today.
It's been such a pleasure, particularly being with you back in the town where I started my career.
Absolutely. Thank you. Just ahead on In Focus, former Congresswoman and current Lieutenant Governor Kathy Hochul joins us after this quick break.